Tonight, we share what we've learned over the last 250-plus episodes about board game criticism on episode 254 of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
So we start off answering a fantastic question from one of our awesome Patreon patrons about what we've learned over the years when reviewing games. And they preview, the first Kickstarter preview we've done in quite some time, of a game called Estate Raise the Realm.
Before that, some introductions. I'm Sean, your host, and here with me we have our editor and webmaster, Deanna.
Hey to all my fellow cardboard connoisseurs out there.
And the Tabletop Bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the Tabletop Bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your game nights better.
We record this podcast live Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop. And we love it when people take part and join in our lobby, our chat room here on Twitch. This episode exists thanks to our Patreon patrons and our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com/episode254. That's 254. Links in our show notes may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing but support us.
The Tabletop Bellhop team is here to answer your gaming and game night questions. Tonight's question comes from one of our awesome Patreon patrons, Pax the Paladin, who writes, I just listened to a ludology episode with Daniel Trudeau, which was great, and it gave me a question. What have you learned from doing game reviews about game criticism? Given your mission statement about making our game nights better, there's probably a lot of consumer guide in your practice of game criticism. Should you buy it or not? Is there more, though? Like thinking through and appreciating the game experience. What games would you say prompt a kind of review that doesn't boil down easily to thumbs up or thumbs down?
Well, I gotta say, that is a fantastic question, Pax, and I think it's going to be an interesting conversation. As well as a chance for us to kind of explain our stance on some important topics when talking about game reviews. This is something that's kind of hitting the social media scene right now. There's a lot of people talking about board game reviewers and what they should and shouldn't do and what it entails and free copies and all that stuff. So we kind of want to, you know, clear the floor and put out our stance on all of these things.
I have to say, though, our reviews never boil down to a simple thumbs up or thumbs down. There's a little bit more to it than that. Yes. And I have kind of wondered that, because some review sites, some content creators are saying, you know, this is a four star game or a 5 out of 6 mm-hmm. or whatever. And we don't do that. And I would be hard pressed to assign numbers to games, because to me, it feels very apples and oranges. Like, unless it's all in the same category, how do you say this is a 5 game and this one's a 4? But they're two very different styles of games. So that's one thing that occurred to me when I was reading Pax's question.
Unless you're talking about Zensu, then we know it's a 5 game.
Yes.
It's a 10. It's a 10. Come on.
Yeah, it's a 10. And I will admit, we did kind of ignore the last part of the question tonight, unless we want to talk about it at the end. But like, what types of games boil down to being different types of reviews? Like, this was not a game recommendation episode. I would say we don't treat different games differently. All games we treat the same. So what we're talking about tonight pretty much appeals to any game we're going to review or talk about.
I think the honest truth is, a really simple party game, we may play less times before we can form an opinion on it.
Yes.
Compared to a complex game. But other than that, we treat them all equally.
Yeah. And I would say none of our reviews boil down to thumbs up or thumbs down. Now, maybe when we first started up, we were a little more, this is positive, this is negative, but not anymore.
Well, game recommendations are kind of the bread and butter of the industry. These are the kind of questions that I really love. I would actually, I say that when we do our group breakfasts as the Tabletop Bellhop team, it's often that we speak about ethics and such things related to the reviews we do in one manner or another.
Yeah. So to put this into context for the folks at home, the three of us go out for breakfast once or twice a month. And like Sean just said, this is the sort of esoteric thing we end up sitting around and debating for, like, you know, 2 hours while the waitress is going, you guys are still here? Okay.
As long as they keep bringing us coffee, we're not going to leave. They should know that by now. But yeah, this and other topics like, oh, do you think our show's too long? Do you think it's too short? Do you think we should do this? Do you think we should do that? Or did you hear the latest controversy over this or that? And does that impact us? Do we want to talk about that? Do we want to make a statement about whatever issue is on hand. And I will say, for the most part, we do tend to stay away from the online debates, at least.
And I will say sometimes we're talking more about podcasting in general, because Sean really gets into the techie side of stuff and likes listening to different content that's not just gaming. So we're sometimes talking about that stuff, too. So, yeah, we get into some interesting debates.
Yes, there is a strong difference between tabletop board game content creation and pretty much every other type of podcast out there, especially tech. Right. Like it's very, very different, at least what people are putting out there. All right. So starting off, the first thing I learned, possibly always known, something that gets debated all the time, but I think is worth mentioning if you haven't internalized this, is that there is no such thing. This is a rare beast. It doesn't exist. It's a unicorn. And that's an unbiased review. They just don't exist. There are lots of different forms of biases, and some are going to apply. And honestly, I don't think that what the bias is, like there's not a hierarchy of biases. There's some that I think are important that people need to acknowledge and people need to be aware of. But the bias from one reason isn't, say, more less of a bias or more of a bias than something else. Like every person reviewing games, you're sharing an opinion. And that opinion is going to be affected by outside influences. Now, the one that's going to make the most sense for people when you first start reviewing, and when we first start reviewing, when I ran the WGR back in 2002, or even just like telling my friends, hey, I played this game, I like it, are games I bought myself. The thing is, people are like, well, if you bought it, you're not biased. I'm like, yes, you are, because you spent money on that game, especially board games. Board games are not cheap. Some are extremely expensive. If I buy a $300 game, I'm going to have a bias there because I bought a $300 game and I spent $300. The amount of money I spend on that game could have been spent somewhere else. Maybe I could have bought 10 other games with that $300 game. Or maybe it's just a really good night out in the town with Deanna where we're trying all kinds of craft beer and getting a fancy dinner and then going dancing afterwards. All of that money could have been spent elsewhere. Then there's the fact I had to find the game. Like I had to go to the local game store, or maybe, and I've done this, I went out to town to go pick up a game. I remember driving around trying to find specific games, driving all the way to London, Ontario, just to pick up something I couldn't get locally. Or I've called multiple stores, or I spent hours online doing research and then finally bought the game. All of that is going to affect how I feel about the game once I have it in my hands.
We were talking about this the other day with Marrakesh. You're like, Deanna, would you like Marrakesh as much if you had to go out and buy it? Because it's an expensive game. And maybe you're biased because we got it as a review copy. And I said, well, maybe I would be biased because I went out and spent that much money on the game and I would have had that pre-bias to like it. Having saved up and bought it, I'd be like, this is my $120 game. It's damn good. Right. You know, so it goes both ways.
Yeah, the only real benefits of buying a game as a reviewer are, one, the PR people can't bug you. Now, that's actually kind of a big bonus sometimes, but yeah, they can't be constantly asking you, where's your content? Have you got that content out for us? And then two, you can speak to the purchase of the experience of purchasing that game. Like Mo was just talking about, you know, having to run around because the game was hard to find in southwestern Ontario, and you might have had to go all the way to London or Toronto to find that game. We miss out on that, but that's about it. On the other side, we would need a lot more sponsors and patrons to be able to buy all of the games that we review currently. So to do that, to buy them, we would either need to review a lot less games, mm-hmm. or we would become deeply beholden to sponsors and patrons and donations, which is a bias in and of itself.
I mean, if we hit the big time or I won the lotto tomorrow or something, I probably would buy more games just for that, not having to be beholden to someone else.
Yeah.
And having those surprise due dates sprung on us, which is one of the parts that I least like about being a content creator, but I am not even going to get into that. So even just before you play the game, your experiences with it can give you a bias, like the experiences that I have at a con. And if someone super engaging gives me a well done overview of the game, I'm going to have a bias towards it going in. compared to if I had only just read about it somewhere, picked it up on the shelf at the store, right? Or if I met the designer or the publisher and they were a fantastic human being in some fashion and we really connected. Well, I can't help but like kind of have a softness towards whatever they're producing, right? I'm going to go in with a bias there.
Now, another one, as far as free games go, what if you get a game as a gift? Well, now I have not the same biases because I haven't bought it. I haven't spent my money, but I'm going to have a bias based on the fact that I got this as a gift. And it's probably going to be impacted by who gave it to me and what I think of that person that gave it to me. And just the fact it is a gift. Now, I didn't have to earn the game or pay for it. But knowing the person who bought it is going to be sad if I don't enjoy it, it's going to play into my factor. And I'm like, oh, I'm going to want to enjoy this because I've wanted this game, or I'm going to try this out. And like that might get me to try a game I normally wouldn't, because I'd be like, well, it was a gift. I got to at least try it out.
Yeah, honestly, reviewing gifts to me feels generally super cringy because you have to assume that the giver of the gift is going to be watching, listening, and it becomes almost a judgment on their ability to gift as a review, as well as a review of the game itself. I feel like there's just no winners there, short of, Mo and Dee giving each other gifts, because that's a different story. But if you get into, external family members and things like that.
I mean, yeah, what would Christmas be if we weren't giving each other gifts for Christmas? That's pretty standard, right? And of course, those are going to end up being reviewed, at least informally, during the Bellhop's Tabletop segment. I know it, right? So, heck, the games we buy our kids end up getting reviewed. And I'm pretty sure your mom would be offended if we didn't review the games that she bought you as gifts.
Yeah, and I don't see anything wrong with it, because I've been reviewing games I've gotten for birthdays and Christmases for years. Like, that's like my initial reviews. That's probably where they came from. And I guess it'd be different if the gift was like from a stranger or something like that. That might be a little different, or like someone you don't know that well. Versus an immediate family. But I don't see a problem reviewing a game as a gift. Like, maybe I should be asking, like, hey, can I review this? Now, what I will point out is if you get a gift from, say, a publisher, that's a totally different thing. And that is a bias you had better declare. You better mention that one. Despite the fact it's a gift. It's kind of like a fancy way of saying a free review copy if you suddenly get a gift.
No, so that one's a little interesting. That's like tricksy. Mess around with FCC type stuff. Let's not go there. Yeah,
exactly. Though we'll get into review copies in a bit. We haven't gotten that far yet. I'm just talking about biases that has nothing to do with whether you're getting review copies on. And honestly, at the end, I brought up playing at a con. Well, the same thing if I go to a public play game night, right? This could be one I'm hosting, someone else hosted, something at the local game store, a tournament, an actual play night, whatever it happens to be. Your biases for the game are going to include how much fun you had at the event, how good the lighting is, how comfortable you were, how good the teacher was, what I thought of the person who brought the game. Because I have had people try to introduce me to games that I don't necessarily enjoy their style of play. They're overly competitive, or they like to sit in silence and nothing social and focus on the game. That's going to affect my view of the game I'm playing. And then like ephemeral stuff, what I had to eat. The public play events I host are at a bar. So if I was drinking, that could go either way, whether I like a game more or less in my impression of it. And one that has happened to me, and I've had it happen to other people, is things are out of your control. Like the venue decides to close early, or the lighting goes all wonky. That can totally change your opinion of the game. And that's going to bias your review, which is part of the reason we try to play things more than once. But it's going to change that first impression of a game.
Yeah, like I thought Cartographers was pretty darn groovy until they turned the lights off at 9 p.m. and I couldn't read the cards. Yeah, this is the same thing I was alluding to with the convention experience. Like, even just a regular old non-press, we're just there as normal people convention experience could color my bias towards a game. Like, I mentioned the positive aspects earlier, but a bad experience with a non-welcoming demo volunteer could also put me right off a game and I'll just never want to play it.
Yeah, and I could cite two semi-specific examples without calling out exact companies or their demo team. But Deanna really doesn't like it when the demo staff throw the game. They very obviously intentionally make it so you win. And she doesn't like it when people tell her how to play, especially when they aren't telling the dudes at the table how to play. So let me get to the big one, the one that everyone wants to talk about. Everyone's talking about online recently, and that is the free review copy. I'm going to mention one right now before I get into some of the stuff I noted down here is free is not free. This is work. Reviewing games is not like this thing that just magically happens. there is a creative process that takes time. So a free review copy doesn't necessarily mean, boom, here, you have nothing. You just now have a game in your collection. So I'm going to throw that out before I continue. So free review copies is the one everyone's talking about. And yes, there's a bias. And it's many of the ones I already mentioned.
I'm going to briefly touch on that whole it's not free thing, in that as content creators, we actually have to claim it as income.
Yes.
If someone gives us a game and they give us a $50 game, it's like we just got $50 in cash as far as the government is concerned.
In Canada, that is. I'm not sure if it's the same in the
US. I don't know US tax law. I just know what I have to deal with.
Canadian here. Tax law, yes. We have to declare our free copies. So a lot of the ones I already mentioned apply to a free review copy as well, right? Your lighting, where you're playing, who you're playing with, all that's still there. But you're going to have other ones. Like, do I like the publisher? Am I worried about upsetting the publisher? Will my review affect my relationship with that publisher? What are other people in the industry going to think of my review? If I say something negative, is that going to be a bad thing? These are all biases that could interplay when getting a free review copy. The actual cost of the game, was it a super big game they sent us? Did they send the deluxe version or did they send the bare bones version? Did they include Kickstarter stretch goals with your version? All of that is going to give you a bias. And one of the things I do want to call out is when you do something with a publisher, other publishers will find out about it. If you don't know this, the industry do talk to each other and they talk to each other a lot. This is not an isolated community of little islands that don't interact with each other.
Okay, so when we're talking about getting games for free from publishers, I'm going to go back. Okay, so just a little while back, Jamie Stegmaier of Stonemaier Games did this big survey of content creators. And then he published one of his nice chatty blog posts that he puts together. And he shared a bunch of stats as part of his findings from that survey. So I'm going to drop a bunch of those stats as we're talking tonight. And here's the first one. The vast majority of reviewers, 96%, receive at least some games for free from publishers. So whether they're disclosing or not, 96% are receiving free games from publishers.
That's insane. That's shouldn't use that term. That's bonkers. That's a ridiculous amount, which isn't surprising to me as someone who creates content. But that's most like just assume any reviewer, board gaming reviewer you're listening to is getting free copies somewhere. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily everything, but getting some.
Now, I hinted at this earlier, but one of the things that comes along with getting these free review copies from publishers is PR people. So even if you are sure, even if you are, you know, absolute that there is no interference between the publisher and the editorial content being created, that doesn't mean you're not going to have someone poking you in the shoulder going, hey, where's our content? Hey, where our Kickstarter goes live on October 12th. Hey, are we going to have it out on time? Hey, where's the video? Hey, you didn't do a video. You only did a blog post. Hey. A lot of that happens. There is a huge PR aspect within the board game industry. The publishers have, you know, teams of people who are out there trying to make sure that content creators like us are getting content out there. And while a good content creator will either brush them off or know in advance and follow the rules, the bad ones may actually be biased and affected by the impact and rush that out for better or for worse. And that could impact the review as to having just, you know, you got the game and you got to it in the pile and you played it and there's the game.
The honest truth is that some publishers or some PR people that rep them are way more enjoyable to work with than others. And when all other factors are equal, the game from the person we enjoy working with is probably going to receive more attention from us or receive it sooner. And that might be on a conscious or unconscious level. And by saying someone is enjoyable to work with, I'm not talking about them giving us cash or bribes or any of that. I just mean people that actually answer your emails and like bother to share our stuff and all of that. Like, it can't help but color your opinion a bit, right? When you have a game from someone you know is going to value the work you do and work with you, you're going to put a little more effort into it.
And that may not actually be making a more positive review or a more negative review, just more content. we may be more interested in tweeting a couple times more often, or doing a, you know, an extra, the unboxing that we might not have done for another content creator. That's the sort of thing that happens generally with those nicer people to work with.
Yeah. Yeah. It doesn't mean I like the game more.
Now, just getting back to other biases, basic things like that could come from something you bought, something a gift, something that showed up on your magic porch, something, a huge package you received, even paid content. When you played, how much sleep you had, who you played with, what time it was, how comfortable your chairs are, what else you played recently, how long did it take, did it meet your expectations? We have multiple episodes talking about that now. Clickbait board games, for example, where you're expecting the game to be one thing and it's something totally different. That's like a preconceived bias before you sat down expecting one thing and then getting denied or lied to. And you're like, what? That's not what I thought I was getting out of this. That's a big one for us. And something we tend to bring up in our reviews when we're surprised by this. Now, sometimes they're pleasant surprises. See, to be fair, most of them, actually, the games still end up good. They're just not what we expect. But that is something that impacts it.
Yeah, I'm blanking on an example. But yes, we've definitely sat down at the table and went, okay, I have to rethink this. This actually is a good game, but I'm feeling grumpy right now because this is not at all what I was expecting. The one I was thinking about was when we played Electric Counts for the first time at the end of a very long convention day, and I was pretty sure it was one of the worst games I'd ever played in my life, and I was questioning why you'd agreed to review it because I was just miserable. And the next time I played it, it was at a coffee shop or out on date night, and I had a wildly differing opinion of that game.
So there's another bias, actually, right there. The reason I agreed to review that is because it said Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay on the cover. That was pretty much it. I knew nothing else about that game except that it was a Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay card game. And I looked at the back and I saw, you know, Carl Franz and Lumping Crooks Fighting Cooks and stuff. And I was like, oh, yeah, I'm in.
So IP bias?
There was an IP bias there. So the point of all that is you're never going to get an unbiased game review. It doesn't exist. Now, the important thing is what we try to do, and I think most reviewers do, and they should be doing it if they don't, is calling out the explicit biases, the ones that matter the most. Now, I'm not going to get into exactly where that line is. That's up to each content creator to draw, and their fans are the ones that are probably going to be the big judge of if they've drawn that line at the right place. But mainly these include existing relationships and collaborations. If you know someone, if you're friends with the game designer, if you meet them at cons every year, if they're sponsoring your podcast, endorsements need to be called out if it's an endorsement, a paid endorsement versus an unpaid piece of content. Review copies, of course, if it is a review copy, we call it out. And well, of course, if there's money changing hands, if it is paid content, if it's no longer a review, which we'll get into in a minute.
So you'll actually even notice on things like our Endeavor Deep Sea unboxing, we mention our sponsorship from Grand Gamers Guild, even though we got the game from a completely different company. Because Grand Gamers Guild is on the box of Endeavor Deep Sea, we need to call that out. Everyone needs to know that there is a relationship there, even though it may not directly impact how we got that game. Every bit of disclosure helps. You, the audience, should understand the relationships involved. Did you know that we have a review policy publicly available on our website? As a listener, I think you should know about it. And read it. It's not just for publishers because it makes it clear where we as reviewers, content creators, stand. We talk about it in the abstract, but understanding how a site you follow reviews things is an important step to trusting those reviews.
All right, I got another stat. It's not quite a stat because this one was inconclusive. So this is a quote from Jamie Stagmeier's survey. If there is an overt bias, example, the reviewer is friends with the publisher designer, or if the reviewer has received money from the publisher in the past for other content, sponsorship, services, etc., the results are mixed. Some reviewers will abstain, others will disclose the bias, and others don't let their bias impact the products that they choose to review. So that's I guess there wasn't enough of a number there to assign a percentage to it. It's just kind of up in the air.
Well, those were the different options you could choose. Right. And there were kind of an even split.
Yeah.
Now, I totally disagree with the last one. No, you can't not let your bias impact the product you choose to review.
Right.
Like, unless you accept every review offer that comes in, no matter who it is, every time you get an email and they say, we want to send you a sample of the game, you say yes. That's about the only way.
Please do not do that, Mo.
Yeah,
please.
I don't recommend you used doing to
do
that.
Do not do that.
I don't see how the bias doesn't impact what you choose to review. I don't feel there's a legal need, possibly not even an ethical need, to call out this person paid us in the past or we had a previous relationship. That one's iffy.
I'm not sure. I think that's actually addressed somewhere in the FCC documents that it is a requirement. You have to say these people paid me in the past. I have had a relationship with them where they have given me something. I'm pretty sure it's in there. I haven't read through it in a while, though.
But I've got to say, I've never heard a podcast who had a sponsor who doesn't have the same sponsor the next year go, well, next year, let's say Grand Gamers Guild, Mark decides he's cutting back on budget and doesn't sponsor our podcast next year. And we're talking about whatever their latest game, Endeavor to the Moon. I don't think we go. And last year, Grand Gamers Guild was a sponsor of our podcast. That just seems extremely awkward.
I don't think we would. It seems like it would be awkward.
On the contrary, on the tech podcast, that does happen all the time. If you're suddenly talking about some technology company, like Cisco, for instance, if Cisco was a former sponsor of the podcast, that gets mentioned.
Yeah.
I suspect they're following FCC best practices. And I just think it's not an industry standard for gaming, and it would sound weird if we did it because it's not an industry standard. Should we technically be doing it?
I don't think this has come up for us ever at this point.
No.
The only other, to me, this seems excessive is we could point out every time we got a review copy, the other review copies they sent previously, which we have kind of called out a couple times. Like we've said, yeah, they sent us this and the expansions. And then the review will be like, they sent us the base game along with these expansions. But not a lot of it. And the one that popped in my head is Quiver Time has sponsored our podcast in the past, quite a few years ago. If we reviewed something new from Quiver Time, it would seem odd to me. So I'd probably just say, we've worked with Quiver Time in the past.
Yeah, that's probably it. And they weren't they sponsored us for 1 month. It's kind of more they bought an ad slot. But it didn't feel like a full on.
But again, do you have to call that out?
Say, they've worked with us in the past.
Yeah, we've worked probably with them in the past is all you need to say. We've worked with them in the past
would probably cover that.
Getting to that, because now we're talking about money changing hands. So first off, in my opinion, there is no such thing as a paid review. Reviews are opinion pieces. Once a review is paid for, it becomes a paid endorsement, an advertisement, or at best, advertainment. This is also true if the person asking you to review maintains creative control. If they have creative control, it is no longer an opinion piece. It's no longer just our words. At that point, I don't think you can call it a review. It is now a different piece of content. Once a publisher wants to review your review before you publish it, you're honestly crossing the line into that they now have creative control, and you have to disclose that they have creative control, and then it becomes an advertisement.
Yeah, no, I feel very strongly about this. I come from a background as a parenting blogger, and I have to say, as soon as a brand wants the right to pre-read my content before I publish it or to start making editorial suggestions, then they are paying me or I'm not doing it. And it is now a sponsored post. And that little line at the bottom where it says, all my words and opinions are my own, that's not there anymore because this is now a sponsored post brought to you by.
Yeah, and this is actually something we just looked at because while we have never allowed editorial control from publishers or other, anyone involved in giving us review copies or anything like that, I noticed when I was reading our own review policy that we hadn't actually explicitly said that. And I thought that it was something worth saying because any journalistic venture worth being called a journalistic venture needs to have a wall between editorial and advertising. Writers must be free to write on topics without the threat of advertisers withholding or impacting their livelihood.
Yeah. And going back to when I was doing the parenting blogging thing, the best brands I worked with would be like, here's a bunch of our stuff. Do something with it. Otherwise, we're not going to keep giving you these things. And you'll have paid opportunities because you are doing this. But do what you want with it. Only do the things you enjoy. Just don't talk about the rest of it. Yeah. And I'm like, all right, I can deal with that. And when I'm saying that I sometimes gave people editorial control, trust me, for me, it was important that I was still only endorsing things I believed in. I know opinions may vary there. I guess that's an ethics thing for me. I'm like, whether I'm paid or not, I'm still not going to say this is really awesome unless I think it is. That's a morality thing.
another term I hear a lot, I see this on Board Game Geek, I see it in various threads about board game reviewing, is that money is the difference between a review and a preview. And I don't agree with that one. I agree with the fact that once there's money involved, it's not a review, but I do think you can have previews that aren't paid. And I know there's kind of a general belief out there that as soon as a reviewer says the word preview, they're getting paid. It's now advertisement. It's now advertising. And well, there's proof of that because we have a unpaid preview that'll be coming up with our review of Estate. Like, we have never taken money for our previews either.
We've always called them previews because I don't want to say it's a review of Estate because we are reviewing an unfinished prototype game. And if I say it's a review of Estate, you might get the wrong idea there. Mo said, can we still call it a preview because it has become more prevalent that a preview is a paid thing? And are people going to assume we're paid as soon as we say preview? So, stat time. Apparently, it is exceptionally rare that publishers offer money to reviewers in exchange for a review. Only 4% said this happens many times.
It is good to hear.
Yeah. It is exceptionally rare that a reviewer requests money in exchange for the review. Only 2% said they do this many times. That should be zero.
I think in that case, once you're down to 2%, I think you possibly have amateurs who don't know better. Hmm. Right?
So there's actually an interesting thing that has just happened recently over September, August area time with Google, actually. So Google had a program where they gave influencers Pixel phones and said, mm-hmm. talk about our phones, we like our phones, blah, blah, blah. Here, feature our phones in your videos. They weren't mm-hmm. asking them to review them. They were just saying, hey, you guys are cool. Here's our phones. Make sure you use them and talk them up. They were mm-hmm. basically saying, be previewers, be paid content sponsors of our mm-hmm. content. But the contract issue, I mean, they were essentially giving away this free stuff for people to make videos with their phones. And it was shut down. I mean, it was, Google has backtracked. They have apologized, and they have completely shut down the PR team who was in charge of this program because they were essentially asking, influencers, not reviewers, but influencers to go out and wave their phone around. Because that's the problem we have right now, is the difference between a reviewer and an influencer is very gray.
Yeah.
And as far as I'm concerned, an influencer is a shill. They're a shill for a lot of different companies, a lot of different things, but they are essentially a shill because they are generally not following the journalistic ethics that we have been talking about throughout this whole thing so far.
No offense to any of your content creators who do follow that and choose to use the term influencer, because I do know many people in the board game industry that call themselves influencers.
That's true. So it's a tag. It's a name. It has connotations. There are people that are doing some dodgy things.
Yes, I won't deny that.
Yeah.
So now we've been talking money and paid content. So one of the thing is, this issue with money is just about reviews. Reviews shouldn't be paid. There are other forms of board game content out there that can and honestly should be paid for. Things like actual plays, how to plays, actual endorsements, advertisements, sponsored content, new game announcements, press releases, all those kind of things. Like, I'm going to pay you to tweet about these games. Perfectly fine, as long as the person who's doing the tweets discloses they're getting paid to tweet about the game.
All right, stat time. Most reviewers who accept money for non-review content will avoid expressing their opinion. 17% differ, most with a disclaimer. So even those who will express an opinion mostly will use a disclaimer, is how I'm reading that. So
yeah. So what that's pointing out is if for anyone who's watched Rotto or Rodney Smith and their how to play videos, they will not tell you their thoughts on the game. They just tell you how to play. You can go to Rodney Smith and try to get his opinion about a game. Good luck.
It becomes fact.
Very strong opinion on the fact that he produces educational content for games, paid educational content for games. He is not there to tell you if he likes the game, doesn't like the game, if he thinks it's fast, if it's slow. Literally as little opinion as possible, hopefully getting to zero. And again, this points out that 17% will add. Now, Rotto will do his other videos where he will share in a separate video his thoughts. So I think that's where that 17% comes in, because then he'll disclose if he's like, I was paid to do a how to play for this game. Now, here's my thoughts on that game. So some people do it. And then, well, we've mentioned it many times. The most important point here is disclosure, right? Like letting people know what those biases are. It should be painfully obvious to your fans what biases exist. You'll always hear us say, thank you, publisher, for providing us with a review copy at the start of a review. And I'll even call out if it's not. I'll be like, hey, I got this one for my birthday. Because again, that's different bias. I didn't have to buy the game. So that might impact my feeling on the game. If it's a $300 game, I didn't have to, you know, feel that pain of spending that money. And if we picked it up ourselves, we'll tend to call it out. Like Deanna and I picked this one up at this local game store up in Chatham. You know, we'll call these things out. And like Sean pointed out, even though Endeavor wasn't our review copy didn't come from Grand Gamers Guild, we called out that we have a relationship with Grand Gamers
Guild. And Grand Gamers Guild didn't even know we had that game.
No. I'm actually surprised Mark didn't give me a copy. I'd be like, oh, I already got that one.
All right, stat time. Most reviewers, 90%, openly disclose in their content if they receive the product for free.
This is an FCC requirement, which applies to Americans. Interestingly, as we were discussing earlier this week, it doesn't actually apply to Canadians, but the companies involved can be affected. So while we may not legally be impacted by the FCC's rules, the companies we work with are. So by us not expressing and disclosing properly, that could impact the companies in America who are influenced by those rules. And so it helps everyone if everyone just follows those rules.
There's Canadian rules too. I just can't remember what they're called right now.
Yeah,
CRCC's and they're very got similar. Stuff. So in general, I just bothered to follow the FCC rules because 99% of who we're working with is American companies. Yes. And I figure that covers all their bases.
And now, to be fair, if you start getting into the UK and the EU, they're even more restrictive over there. You better be disclosing. You will get shut down as a content creator if you don't disclose. Now, interestingly, that disclosure could just be a little hashtag ad up here in the corner of our video that we don't even have to point to. They do have different rules on how you have to do it, but you do have to disclose everything over there, which is interesting.
Now, interestingly, one thing we've been talking about is how publishers might or might not influence content creators. Well, going back to that discussion I had about influencers and influencers versus reviewers, we are now in a weird state in the world where influencers can actually impact and affect the publishers to some degree. While the board game industry is smaller, there are still content creators out there who have enough clout to be able to throw their weight around in a negative and improper way, should they ever choose to. Now, I'm not saying anyone does. I'm not making any claims. I'm just saying that the possibility exists. And I want to take something, you know, completely outside of the board game. If, for instance, Mr. Beast, one of the largest content creator influencers in the world, were to go to a game company like Grand Gamers Guild, who's a couple of people, you know, a couple of people in a small office, that would be influential and, you know, towards the publisher. You know, if Mr. Beast said, hey, Mark, we want to do something with your games, give us all your games right now, it would be hard for Grand Gamers Guild to easily say no, because, well, Mr. Beast is Mr. Beast. And I think we all know the sort of clout and influence that he could bring to a product if he so chose to. And so you've got that sort of reverse influence happening.
Because what I want to get into next is our kind of process, how we review games, what we think is important to cover.
I'm going to very quickly say that because I have been doing this for 14 years in some format or another, watching the way that disclosure and the ethics behind this have developed has been very interesting, but I'm not going to segue and go off on it, but I could talk about it in a ranty way for a long while. No, we should get into the crux of PAX's question about how we review games.
Maybe PAX and D can get a thread going on the Discord.
Maybe we'll do a patron-only Deanna Talks influencer marketing in board games or something of that sort. For anyone who's listened to our reviews, you're going to know most of this already, but the way we review games is a focus on what the game looks and feels like, with the component quality and the presentation. That's what we always start off with. Sorry, we start off with the basic facts of it plays this many people. Here's who published it. Here's where you can get it, right? That is kind of a given. We do like to call out the designer, where possible, the artist. Sometimes we even throw in a developer there. That's something I think is important because there's a lot of people behind the scenes in the board game industry that don't always get the recognition they do. So I'm going to kind of throw that in first. So once we got the basic facts, you know, it's a 3 to 5 player card game by this publisher. We get into, like I said, what the component quality, right? The presentation, iconography, how good the rule book reads, some kind of general overview. Then we get into what the game plays like. This is, to me, one of the more important parts of it, which generally includes an overview of play. Now, over the years, we've shifted from a detailed, almost how to play level of detail in the game to what I'm trying to do is an overview of play that's detailed enough for people to be able to tell if it's your kind of game. For you to go, oh, it's got this mechanic. I recognize, I like that mechanic. Or, oh, that sounds fascinating to me before. I've never heard it before. So that's more what the focus is on now. We want people to be able to tell if it's their kind of game. And then at the very end, the last thing we do, which is sometimes the largest segment, is our thoughts on the game. Now, that first part's pretty straightforward, right? Like it's, we cover the game. We go to the facts. Here are the facts. Here's how the game looks, right? This is where we're trying not to interject much opinion. Though every now and then we'll throw in a little comment along with some of the facts. But the next thing we are going to do, the second part, the last bit where we're sharing our thoughts in the game, I think is worth expanding on. And that is that we will share our personal feelings about the game. But the big thing that we like to bring to the table is the impressions we get from other people we play with. I'll call out if my family enjoys it, if my girls enjoyed it, if my mother-in-law liked it. I'll mention if my gamer friends liked it, back when we used to have a regular game night here. I'll mention if it's gone well at public play events. We are going to call out specific things people liked and didn't like. We really got into that with Panda Royale last week when we were talking about it. Now, that was kind of after the review where we were talking about how different groups reacted to the game based on the different player counts. Now, we're always going to try to highlight the good and the bad, but with an explanation. We're never going to say, this game's too random, I don't like it. Like, that's just not our review style. I'm going to say, you know what? This mechanic I found very random. You know what? The deck of cards was so thick. There were so many copies of the cards. I had no idea what could be coming up. It just felt purely random. And it was just too random to me. I didn't feel like I had enough control. I couldn't plan ahead because I didn't know what was going to happen. That's more something we will say. We'll call it that one specific mechanic. But then we'll expand to say things who might like that. Because there's certain things we don't like in some games that other people will enjoy. We might be like, hey, the randomness in this was a downplay to me. I want my games to be more perfect information, strategic. But you know what? Randomness is really good for leveling the playing field. When you have players of different skill level, randomness gives those players that aren't as skilled or don't have as much system mastery a chance to learn the game and play better and have a chance of still winning. So for family game night, maybe that randomness is appreciated. Like, so that's just kind of vague examples without mentioning specific games.
And it's interesting because we have spent a lot of time talking about how much of the game, of the mechanics, of the play do we put into the reviews. And it's changed a lot. If you go back to our early reviews, you can follow a path of shifting quantity and sort of specificity on how much the game. We always said this isn't a teach, it's a review, but we were getting pretty close to teaching some games.
We had more of a disclaimer in case we got something wrong.
We had to rein Mo in. There was some heated debates there.
Yeah. But the fact that there are three of us in front of the camera now is one thing, because we're all different gamers. But there's also three more immediate family members right there behind Mo and Dee all the time in our reviews, as well as friends all around Windsor who, even if they don't always know it, are part of the input we use to develop our reviews.
Yeah.
You know, and then there's things like, you know, Mo loves Dex games. I can enjoy some Dex games. Dee kind of hates them. Dee adores that deep strategy, the SATs in board game format level of thinking, whereas I prefer generally a more lightweight, casual game. I like a game where I can be chatting with people and enjoying time socially as I play a game. So while these aren't the only things we love, the only kind of games we love, they are part of our biases and the thought processes that go into our reviews and why our reviews are broad due to it.
Okay. I'm going to jump ahead to one of the stats I had pegged to say later because it really fits well here. Most reviewers, 78%, will accept tabletop products for review even if they include genres, themes, and mechanisms that they don't typically enjoy. But the thing here is, Sean was talking about the different types of games that we like. By having three of us, we kind of cover our bases by there being a wide variety of games that do fit into something one of us will enjoy, for one thing. But we do a lot of pre-vetting to make sure that the games we're getting kind of lean towards things we would enjoy, and we don't just say yes to everything. That's a big factor, too. And I can't, I think maybe that 78% just comes from how widely varied the field is and how many new people there are to it. And I think that first year when we were first doing this, you said yes to anything. You were so excited. Someone wanted us to work with them, that vetting process, it was a much higher bar that people, now they got a limbo. Okay. But like, it was a much higher bar. So, we were saying yes to things that we found we didn't enjoy, and we've kind of figured out not to do that.
Well, and I think part of that goes to another part of our review aspect, which is the amount of play that we put into games. We don't just play a game once and then review it. We talk about it after we play it once. We don't review it after we've played it once. Whereas if you are willing to accept anything, if you're willing to just take all comers, you get to a point where you don't have the time to play something five times and review it because your stack of games that are coming in every week doesn't allow you the time. And so that allows us to be more particular about what we get. Right. Why would we want to spend time playing over and over again, you know, the latest Pimple Popper game when we aren't going to enjoy it? It's not going to be something that we review positively. So why not, you know, get the game that will?
I would almost say almost the first part of our review process is doing that due diligence to figure out if we even want to take the game or not.
Yes. What we do try to do in our reviews is point out what we liked and didn't like, what we think other people will like and won't. And specifically, we'll tend to call out things where if you like this mechanic, you'll like it in this, or if you like this style of game, or if you like this theme, or if you like this game type, you won't. And then the final part of our reviews, and I think this is the most important thing we do, in my opinion. This is my feeling. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe someone should call us out on this. But we always finish off by recommending the game to different groups, potentially calling out groups that should avoid the game. The recommendation is often, if you don't like this, don't buy this game. Don't look at this. Though we'll usually be a little generous and say, but give it a try because maybe you'll like it. Because there are a lot of really good games out there that we review and we're like, man, even if you don't like trick taking, you should give this one a shot. We do tend to do that quite a bit. And this includes more than mechanics, right? We'll talk about the tone, how it feels, how it makes you think. If it feels like an interesting logic puzzle, we'll try to call those things out, not just necessarily pure mechanics.
You know, and I'm going to be honest and say, I couldn't pull this off. It is kind of like your special skill to be able to go, this game is also like X and Y. And if you've ever played Z, you're going to love it. It's you have that synthesis of knowledge. That's why you get to be the tabletop bellhop. But
that's why I get the hat.
Yeah. And our goal is always being to match people up with the right games for them. Not the right games for us, but the right games for them, because not every game is for everyone. And that's an awesome thing.
Now, one of the things, kind of getting back to what we were talking about there when we kind of went off track for a bit, is we, as part of our due diligence to be able to recommend the games to different groups, is we have to play it with different groups, right? Like, it's not just the synthesis knowledge because I played all these games, because I want to try it with different people. Every game we play, we try to try with different groups of players. We try to play them at different player counts. We'll try the solo mode. There's a solo mode in the game. We will play the games multiple times. And honestly, a new one that's new to us. And I don't know what's going to happen when she goes to university. But right now we actually have like an extra voice in the mix because Gwen now runs the board game club at her high school. And she comes home after every event and tells me what they played and what people liked and what they didn't like. And I'll recommend games for her to play. I'll be like, oh, try bringing this one out, see how it goes. And sometimes they're total flops with her demographic and age group and the people that come out to her game nights. And other games are extremely popular. there is a game that we have debated even calling a game that is actually one of the most popular games from that group. So to me, that's actually a big part of our due diligence in being able to recommend games for different groups is to try them with different groups. Now, no, we can't try them with everyone. And no, I don't know, you know, a group that only plays family games and a group that only plays heavy games and a group, and I bring the game around to all of those. That's just not feasible. But we try to get it played with as many different groups as we can before we talk about it within a reasonable time limit, right? Yes, I could hold every game in our pile until we play them 10 times each with 10 different groups at every possible player. It's not that. To me, there's a line there. In some games, you can play them once or twice and realize the whole game. Other games, a good example is Hamburg. You got to play it 10 times, 8 times, 9 times to fully explore the game to get a really good feel for it.
And that developed over time that we realized yes. that was a key component to be able to give a fair review.
And one thing that this also helps with, not just getting a better feel for the game and who it works for and who it doesn't, but playing it those extra times helps with mistakes. Mm-hmm. And we all know that you're going to play a game extreme sometimes. We talk about it all the times. But if you're only playing that game once before you review it, or even twice, how do you know that those aren't your extreme plays? We have seen reviewers who have ranted about some aspect of a game and how it ruined the game for them, except we knew that they had played that part of the game wrong. They had made a mistake, and their review of the game was biased by the fact that they didn't play by the rules. Mm-hmm. And so playing it those extra times has allowed us on some occasions to go, oh, wait, this is our third time playing the game, and we just realized that this one mechanic, we got backwards. We need to do something different. To be fair, there have been times where even after five games, when reading the rule book as we write the review, because we do double check things and check the rule books as we're writing the reviews, we go, oh, hold on.
We've actually put a pause on a review because we need to go back and play this again because we weren't even playing it right.
Yeah, there's been a couple Wednesday morning, Tuesday night, one more plays just to see how things feel differently. That's definitely happened. Now I'm going to go to something Sean was calling about PR companies pushing you and creative control from publishers. One thing I would like to hear where publisher, I do want them to reach out to us is if we make a rule mistake. If we point out something that is factually wrong about your game, please tell us. And then we will offer an apology in our next episode.
Fact checking? Yes. Fact checking and telling me I screwed something up, by all means, is very much different than telling me my opinion is incorrect.
Yes. Yes. Don't write to us and say, you know, you made dumb decisions or you did not play this correctly because you didn't follow the scripted or you played this totally wrong. And I point out to you, well, that's not in the rule book. That's a little different. But yeah, please call us out on actual mistakes. Now, another feature of our content, something that I feel strongly about, is that we are not a board game hype show. We are not focused on reviewing the new hotness as soon as it comes out and only talking about the hottest games. One of the main reasons for that is there are a bunch of other people who are really good at that, and I'll let them have that niche. Feel free. Have fun. There's lots of you out there. Good luck to you. Thank you for letting me know about what games I should be hyped about. Yes, sometimes we get hyped about a game and we'll talk about it early. Our review of King's Coalition is a good example of that. We saw the game at Gamma. We saw it at Origins. It looked fantastic. We asked for a review copy. We brought it home. We reviewed it. And then it wasn't until I went to throw in an affiliate link and I'm like, oh, this game's not out yet. Okay. So it was kind of a surprise for us, but that's happened a couple times. It's not often that we talk about games that are brand new. Most of the games we're reviewing are months, if not years old sometimes. Now, one of the things I like about that is it lets me see if a game has staying power. Like if it's 6 months later, are people still talking about whatever game it is? It'll be interesting to see with King's Coalition because it's one we did put out content early or other game, right? Like, are people still talking about this? And even more so, I love discovering that hidden gem, that great game that it seems like people missed. And usually we can kind of do the research to figure out that, you know what? That came out at the same time the Kenner Spiel Awards were awarded and everyone else was looking at over here. And it seems like they missed this game. I always enjoy that part.
And one other nice thing about doing games that have been out for a little while is it lets us avoid that PR problem we were talking about earlier. Yeah. You don't have a PR manager going, hey, when's your content coming out? When's your content? If the game's been already on the shelves for 2 years.
Now, this one thing I want to talk about, and this kind of goes with what games we select. We kind of talked about this a little bit already, but one of the things is only saying nice things and overall positive reviews. Now, our reviews do tend to be overly positive. Overall positive. Most of our reviews are positive because we try to focus on facts about the game, first of all, before sharing our opinion. And once that's done, our thoughts are our own. Now, we're not afraid to say something negative. And honestly, like when I saw some of the discourse going around right now about this, I had never even considered the fact that saying something bad about a game may mean the publisher won't work with us anymore. And honestly, I got to say, if that's the publisher that we're working with, I don't think I want to work with them anyway. If that's their attitude, that if you say something bad about my game, I don't want to work with you. To me, that would be a total disservice to our friends and fans. If we just sugarcoated everything, like then we're getting into pandering and advertisement that we're not getting paid for. I don't know.
There are some content creators out there that are overly negative and ranty and sort of clickbaity in that way. And maybe as a publisher, I'd be like, maybe that's not someone I want to work with. I could see that.
Okay. That's a little different.
Yeah. All right. Stat time. If a reviewer plays a game they intended to review, but doesn't like it, responses are varied. Many will proceed with the review. 62% would go ahead and review it. Yep. Or contact the publisher with questions. 20%. Well, some will choose not to create a review at all. 20%. I'm going to say we've done all three.
Yeah, though so not as much anymore. I'm much towards the just publish the review.
We have asked questions.
There used to be a time where I would reach out and ask questions. But then I think it was a conversation we had over breakfast with Sean, where it pointed out not everyone has access to the designer to be able to contact them. Because we have mm-hmm. that relationship, that privilege, we can answer those questions. We really should be reviewing the game based on what the person who bought it off the shelf gets. Now, we often will talk about going on BoardGameGeek. Now, that's something mm-hmm. people can do. We do look at FAQs. We do check for the latest version of the rules. We look for errata. But very seldom will I reach out to a designer anymore to look for clarification.
It has happened. If we're getting answers from the designer or publisher and that makes the game great and more playable and enjoyable for us, that's not the experience that the normal person's going to be having. So we're not giving them a fair review. Yeah.
And as for choosing not to create a review, that has happened very seldom. And I got to say, those games were bad. Mm-hmm. They have to be pretty bad when we get to that point. And in that case, we did reach out to the people and say, I can publish this if you want, but this is going to be ridiculously negative. Like, these are games that were unplayable as presented. Mm-hmm. You don't want my review to be, this is unplayable, don't buy it.
I've got another stat here, sorry. Only a small number of reviewers, 4%, are very worried about expressing negative opinions and that will lead to fewer publishers sending them products for review. However, at least 44% are at least a little worried about this.
Yeah, see, that's sad.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. Now, that being said, most of our reviews are positive and sometimes overwhelmingly so. But that's not because we're being nice. Trust me. There are more than a few games out there that at least one of us has not enjoyed and said as much. Dragon Dice. But we very carefully vet the games we're taking to review. We do not say yes to every review opportunity, and we often turn down games we just don't think we would enjoy. And now, a message from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
So we've got some exciting news for you Holiday Hijinks fans out there. And honestly, more importantly, for the people out there that heard us talk about these games and rave about these games and review these games, but haven't actually picked up any yourselves.
The first thing you want to know is that there are three new games coming to the series. Listen to these titles, folks. We've got Leprechaun Larceny, The New Year Nightmare, and The Krampus Caper. And that is in addition to The Marriage Mix-Up, which was released at Essen. In total, that brings the number of games in the Holiday Hijinks series to an even dozen.
Now, here's the exciting part for new and potential fans. In addition to three new 18-card escape room games, we are happy to announce the Holiday Hijinks collection, where you can get all 12 of these puzzle games in a collector's box.
Now, if somehow you missed us raving about these games over the last couple of years, just go check out our reviews on YouTube, on the blog, social media. My family loves these games. They're one-hour escape room experiences. And honestly, one of my favorite parts about these is that you don't have to destroy anything to play them. The pro tip here is put the cards in sleeves if it asks you to write on them. So once you finish these, you can pass them on to your family, friends, as a gift. Give them to someone else. Hide them on Christmas morning. Hide them at your neighbor's house on Easter, and they'll be like, what the heck is this? I love the fact that you don't ruin them, like, because so many escape room games are one and done. These are one and done for you. You're not going to want to play them again, but you can easily give them to someone else.
So all of this, the new games and the collector's box, is going to be available through a new Kickstarter project that is launching on October 15th. And they're setting it up so that you're able to pick any single game, any combination of games, or the full collector's box to purchase. So that's pretty cool. The Kickstarter page is live now, and I encourage you to go and click the notify on launch button.
One announcement before we start talking about the games we've been playing.
So next week, October 8th and 9th, which I know is this week for those of you listening at home, it's going to be Amazon Prime Big Deal Days, which seems to be the new official start to holiday sale season. If last year was any indication, this is going to be big. This is going to be as big as Prime Day in the summer, with great, often best of the year deals. And one of the things we noticed last year is that Prime Big Deal Days had better deals than Black Friday in many cases for our industry, for the hobby board game stuff. There were some fantastic deals.
And y'all know our side gig is telling people about when board games are on sale. So this means that Mo and I are going to be very busy next week. So I'm sorry to say we won't be recording next Wednesday.
Even though we aren't recording, there's a chance you might still see some new content next week. We're currently working on trying something new for the show that involves splitting our single recordings on Wednesday into two episodes or an episode and a half episode.
Or something like that. We haven't actually figured out the details yet. And it's still possible you might just get a full episode Tuesday morning and nothing next Tuesday. You'll have to wait and see. It's all very experimental right now.
This is something we've been talking about for a bit that'll allow us to keep a more regular release schedule for things like con season or when Sean's work sends him out of town or when everyone in the family comes down sick, you know, life stuff.
And what would really help make this work is feedback. If we do change things up, please let us know what you think. Reply to our newsletter or send us an email, Mo or D or Sean at tabletopbellhop.com, or better yet, CC all three of us. Check out the feedback section of our Discord. Send us a DM, whatever. We want to know what you think, especially if you don't like it.
Yeah, if we change something for the worse, please let us know if you do not like it. I did call this out in our newsletter that went out today. So all of our newsletter subscribers would have got a kind of heads up about this happening as well. And I did ask everyone there, like, you can just hit reply. Yeah, that comes right back to us, which is kind of nice.
Rebuild your lands after the Great War in Estate, Raise the Realm, an action selection worker placement engine building board game coming soon from Grodd Games LLC.
So this is a preview of Estate Raise the Realm, which will be soon launching on Kickstarter. Grodd Games provided us with a prototype copy of the game, which we'll soon be sending off to another content creator. Now, we have been promised a copy of the finished game if this project is successful.
The version of Estate we are talking about today is based on a nearly finished version of the game. We used the most up-to-date version of the rulebook and were provided with some updates and clarifications from the designers. We already know that the victory point values of cards, the names of some actions, and some other aspects of the game are still being developed. We have been assured that the core game mechanics, the way things play and feel, will be staying the same.
Our copy of Estate Raise the Realm was very polished for a prototype, including dual-layered player boards, wooden pieces, cardboard tokens, and cards with medieval fantasy art, a solid layout, clear iconography, and English card text. The game has an overall appealing table presence.
Now, part of this table presence is a cardboard castle you build and put over the card deck. And while this looks cool and might draw people in, and like when I first saw the game at Origins, I'm like, oh, check that out. That sticks out. We found it rather impractical while playing. It doesn't have an in-game purpose. It blocks the view of the board from the backside, and it's a bit of a pain to pull cards out from under it. Now, it doesn't seem to serve any other purpose other than to look cool. So I will say after our first couple plays, that didn't get set up anymore.
Yeah, it gives you a place to put the workers you haven't purchased yet, but they can be set anywhere on the board.
Yeah.
I am going to say for a table presence, I forgot to put this in the notes, so I'm going to add in now. I really like the artwork. I thought they did solid with the artwork. Our version of Estate plays 2 to 5 players. The finished version should also include a solo mode. Game length on the box ranges from 45 to 75 minutes, which seems a bit short when playing with 4 or more players.
The game of Estate Raise the Realm is played over 5 eras. Each era, players will use their workers to choose between 4 basic actions. These actions revolve around collecting cards, collecting resources to play those cards, and adding cards to a growing tableau.
So cards in this game come in 2 types. There's buildings and citizens, and they each also have 3 categories. And each card has 1 of these 3, either noble, production, or progress. Every time you play a card into your tableau, you're going to advance on a track which matches that category, which will impact how powerful your future actions will be.
Players score victory points for every card in their tableau, for gold collected, for resources stored on cards, for cards tucked under other cards, for your personal gold card, for completing any of the 3 tracks, and for majorities awarded at the end of each era.
A game of Estate starts with the players choosing or randomly selecting a noble leader of a great house. These are very asymmetric, each starting with different cards in play in their estate, providing a different once-per-era ability, and having different values on the 3 tracks.
So each era starts by revealing an event card. These can be positive or negative and impact all players. They also set an era goal for that round, which will award players points, cards, and/or resources, depending on how well they rank, based on that goal at the end of the right era.
Players then take turns taking actions with their workers until everyone is out of workers. All the players start the game with 4 workers, but there are ways to hire more, including temporary workers, which you only get to use for 1 era.
Actions include drawing cards, the amount based on the current value of your noble track. Cards can be drawn from a face-up 4-card market or from the deck. There is no hand limit.
Now you can play cards from your hand by discarding the resources shown at the top of the card. Cards are added to your growing tableau, which is your estate. You immediately go up on the track matching the card played. Cards include production cards, when played cards, end of game scoring cards, and persistent effects. There are a ton of different cards in this game and effects, including things like drawing more cards and playing another card cheaper, or awarding gold or storing resources on cards, and tucking cards, which is placing a card face down behind the card with the tuck ability.
Take the production action to activate your production cards and get whatever they provide. And this is usually resources, but could be all kinds of other things like tucking cards in the dungeon, assassinating citizens, and more. The number of cards you can activate each production action is based on the level on your production track.
The final action is actually an opportunity to take one of a group of actions that are on the main board. These include taking resources from piles that accumulate each round, getting another worker to a max of 6, discarding cards for resources, and taking what are called special progress actions.
So there are 4 progress actions that are on the board, and you randomize what's up each game. So these change. They're ranked progress 1, 2, 3, and 4. And you can only use one of these actions if you've unlocked that level on your progress track, one of the 3 tracks that you have on your player board. These tend to be very powerful abilities that can be only used once per era per player.
They can only be used by 1 player per era because then the spot's taken up. At the end of each round, players receive awards based on how they rank for the current era goal. The market gets wiped and new cards are drawn. The accumulation spots on the main board get filled with resources, and the first player passes to the left.
At the end of the 5th, or potentially earlier, At the end of the 5th era, or potentially earlier, if the Cataclysm negative event comes up, players total their points, and the player with the most points wins.
So this is a case where one of the game's designers actually reached out to us to see if we'd be interested in previewing their game. Now, we were impressed because they obviously did their work and they knew our show and they actually read our review policy. Now, at this point, we pretty much stopped producing previews for various reasons I don't want to get into. But the fact Grodd Games did this research and we agreed to check out the game at Origins during the media first look. And it was after seeing the game there, how polished it looked and how complete it seemed that we did agree to check this out.
Yeah, I stood by while they were explaining the game over to you, some other folks, and I decided the game looked interesting and that it looked like a complete game, something that is often lacking in prototypes.
Now, some interesting choices were made for a prototype, as one doesn't usually see dual-layered boards and fitted 3D buildings before the rules and game balance are taken care of.
Now, unfortunately, right now, with the copy of the game we have and the version that's out there, the rules aren't great. And going with the card text and values on our prototype, the game wasn't quite as far as along we'd hoped. That said, we have already been shown quite a few improvements and different versions of the rules and changes that have already been made. And it does look like Grodd is making tweaks and improvements. And I will say at this point, I'm confident that they will continue to get closer to launch. And more so during the campaign, they will continue to improve it and tweak it and fix these small issues. Now, I don't want to get into the nitty-gritty of what was wrong and what we want to see improved. I don't think that actually helps anyone. What I want to emphasize here was how good we expect this game to be. And the reason for that is that I've actually really enjoyed every game of Estate Raise the Realm that we play. This is a solid game with some cool things going on.
Right, like, how do I explain this? The rule book is in flux, and there are definitely some rules and some card texts that need clarification, but at their core, the rules don't need to be changed or fixed. They just require some additional explanation and clarity. The rules, as we played them, are fun. It's a fine game. There's a game there and an enjoyable game.
Yeah, I admit I was pleasantly surprised at this, as we have had a mixed bag when it comes to previews. While not polished, the game has some really good underpinnings that means there is a strong game there to be had.
Now, a lot of parts of this game to me just felt familiar, being someone who plays a lot of different hobby board games. There's just a lot of tried and true mechanics that most other hobby board gamers are just going to be familiar with. Like the accumulation of the resource market reminds me of Agricola. At the start of the round, you put a thing on every token and they build up. And when someone takes them, they get everything there, right? Tucking of cards and storing on resources definitely feels like Wormspan, being in, and I assume Wingspan's the same. The tableau building kind of reminds me, you know, San Juan Race for the Galaxy, where I'm building up my empire. Now, what sticks out in this game, though, is the way these have all been combined into a very cohesive game.
Cohesive, but not simple. Like, it's not a gateway game. It's not difficult or overly complex, but it's not a beginner's game.
Yeah, there's enough going on and enough of a point salad, such as it is, that you don't want to walk into this blind as a new gamer.
Now, what feels unique to me is the way these traditional mechanics are tied to the tracks. Those tracks, to me, kind of make the game and make it kind of stand out compared to other tableau building games. You've got the three tracks. There's Nobles, Production, and Progress. And that reminds me a bit of Endeavor, Endeavor Age of Sail, even the older version of Endeavor. Now, where this really sticks out to me and where you see it the most is the production action. That's the one that people are probably going to use the most often. I like the way that, in general, taking production does not mean activate all your production buildings. You're not going to be activate all your cards. And then there's the way the more production buildings you own, the more you will get to activate. So there's that escalation. Now, the progress track, on the other hand, was interesting, mainly because after multiple plays, I didn't really like the progress cards. I didn't really necessarily want those in my estate, but I really like the ability that the progress levels enable, where you can use those progress spots on the main board. So I found myself playing cards into my tableau, not for their ability, but just to raise that track, which I thought was an interesting decision point.
Right? Or you might end up playing a production card or two and you aren't really wild about what it produces, but you're doing it simply so you can up the number of overall production cards that you can activate. So, it's an interesting mechanic that leads to interesting choices, and I really dig it.
And on top of that, the asymmetry involved is just another level, because while everyone's working on their tracks, you aren't all starting with the same values in your tracks. Mm-hmm. Some people, your track might start at one, some might start at zero. I don't know if there's any that start at two, but there is a variety of where those tracks are starting at and moving to, which again changes how you're going to be playing the game. Mm-hmm.
And it's not just where they start. Like, one character might have four ones before there's a two, or another character might have two ones, then two twos, then threes. Like, it's not even just the starting value. The entire tracks can be completely different. And then in addition to that, each character is also unique in other ways. What cards start in play? Every character starts with at least one card in play, most of them with at least two cards. And some of those cards lead to more cards being played before you even start. So there's a different, complete starting ground. Then everyone has a unique ability that you're allowed to use once per era. And what I found is they really push you towards certain strategies and combos and buying certain types of cards. And playing the Agrigarian Lord with their starting farm and quarry felt very different from my last game, where I played the Pious Lord, who was very much focused on nobility cards and the ability to draw more cards so you can go fish for those nobility cards.
Yeah, I really enjoyed the asymmetry, and having played multiple characters and seeing other characters played at the table, I felt that each one felt significantly different. And it's a small thing, but I really like that you start with cards in play based on your character.
Yeah, it was interesting. The first character I got to play, actually, the special ability and their starting cards didn't actually come into play because of the choices that my opponent made. So there's all that aspect as well. You know, there is some playing off each other's activities and things. It's not just a multiplayer solitaire.
Yeah, most definitely not. Actually, there's quite a bit, including direct confrontation. There are cards that will target other players and steal resources and steal cards and make you discard cards. That is an aspect of the game. Now, the other thing I liked was there's a bit of engine building puzzle aspect of figuring out card combos and even action sequences. Like, if I do this, then this, I get more. Like, I want to sit there and make sure I put my forester in play before I go grab wood off the main board, because then I get a bonus card. Because, like, there's that puzzle I like. I like that in any game. I like those puzzle aspects where you're trying to optimize your turn or figure out these combos. And you can definitely build an engine in this game if you get the right cards. Like, having a lumberyard, a forest, royal woods, and a coal burner, you're going to get some sweet points every era just by taking a single production action.
Yeah, and I felt like we just scratched the surface with the potential card combos here. There are some very interesting possibilities.
Now, the biggest problem I found with the game was a high randomness factor. And this came up in a variety of ways. And I will fully admit, I don't know how much this will be an issue in the finished game. But all we had was our prototype copy. So one of them was the random era events. In our copy of the game, there is a 50% chance that a Cataclysm card will be in play. When that card comes up at the start of an era, that is the last era of the game. That is the last round. And that can come up in era one. So you might play only one era. Now, if it comes up in the last spot, your game ends immediately. You don't even play that era, so you have no idea it's coming. So you just don't have a fifth era. I really didn't like that. Honestly, we pulled that card out for some of our plays because we just didn't want to see that. Now, another one is how thick the deck is. There's a massive deck of cards here, enough that the player sitting behind it might not be able to see some of the actions in front of it. Like, it's a huge deck of cards, and the card distribution, I haven't quite figured out. And honestly, to me, it feels like I want to pull out one of each card just to make it smaller. And when this matters is when you have cards that key off other cards. There are some very specific cards, like, this gives you a discount if you play this. And in one game, Deanna started the game with a monk in her hand. Well, you get points for every monk in play. So she got that up right away, only to us to go for the entire game without even seeing another monk card, to the fact that Deanna then had me grab the deck to look and see if there were more monk cards. There were. And the last game we played, I didn't draw. Now, see, Sean was saying it was my play that meant his ability had gone off. Well, I didn't draw a single production card until the third era. And I was playing the Pious Lord, which let me draw extra cards.
Yeah. Okay. First off, the random card factor. As Mo said, the deck is quite large. And in any given game, you're only going to work through a fraction of it. Yeah. And this is especially true in a two-player game. all of those cool card combos fall apart if you can't find the cards that work together. It just becomes a frustratingly bad game of Go Fish.
Yeah, I haven't played this at five players. I suspect the deck may well be tuned for that large player count. But unfortunately, what that means is when you move down to smaller player counts, because there is no mechanic to adjust that deck distribution, mm-hmm. it starts to suffer.
Now, we have played it four player, and we did not even get through half the deck. So even four player, we're not getting through the whole thing. Now, that will matter what people do. The more people take the draw action, the quicker you're going to go through the deck. So it is player dependent. So when I look at this game, when I read the theme of this game, when I see production actions and building buildings, and I expect a very strategic Euro game. And that randomness felt out of place to me. I don't know if it's just me or my expectations. Now, I do know, on the other hand, this randomness leads to a quicker, more tactical game where you have to deal with what you got. And that also makes the game more accessible for younger players and less experienced gamers, as well as leveling the playing field for players who have more skill than others. By making it randomness can be a way to balance a game. And I don't know if that was a design goal here or supposed to be a feature, but it's not what I wanted from this.
Okay, I'm going to address the era events. So we just received an email from the designer earlier today saying that including the Cataclysm card is actually an optional rule set. So the fact that we left it out, sometimes we're on the right track. The email also mentioned another small tweak they've made is that the era event for the first era must be positive, which I think makes sense. It's much more enjoyable to get off to a good start before all the awful things happen.
Yeah, which I think is just a good indication that they are tweaking things.
Yeah, mm-hmm. No, they're definitely making choices, making understandings. Again, it felt like it hadn't been fully blind play tested. The balances of things were off. The concepts were all there. It was just literally changing numbers here and there and tweaking the tiny dials.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what it feels like. Is like, well, of course you don't play the Cataclysm card unless you do this. Or of course you don't put a negative error card in the first error when you're setting it up. But they forgot to write that down somewhere. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're playing it with the designer, the game is perfect. If you're playing it by yourself, the rules struggle.
So overall, I think Estate Raise the Realm is going to be a very solid game when it's finished. We have all enjoyed the game as it stands, despite some clarity and balance issues, some over-the-top randomness. I can't see it not just getting better. And even just the feedback we got today fixes an issue I had with the game. I'm like, that Cataclysm card's ridiculous. A 50% chance your game gets over? Like, how do you predict that? How do you play towards that? That's just too random. Well, it ends up that wasn't intended. So, like, we can already see that it's getting better today. Like literally today, which I find kind of amusing. I think this is just the more feedback they get, the more they hear, like, this is going live on Kickstarter. You know that the Kickstarter backers are going to tear apart the rule book. I don't know if this is on Board Game Arena, but people are going to find ways to play it. They're going to get that feedback, and I think it's going to make it better. Honestly, at this point, I'm glad we got to check this game out, and I'm looking forward to seeing where it develops, what it turns into, because I'm liking it now. I'm not loving it, and I have a feeling it might hit that spot with the right tweaks.
Yeah, there haven't been...
Really looking forward to checking out that final version.
Yeah, there haven't been too many previews where I haven't become pretty frustrated. I tend to be more down on these previews than most people. Whereas in this case, I could really see the potential this game has. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't there, and that was frustrating to me. But unlike the fact that it felt, you know, it didn't feel like a complete dumpster fire. It felt like something that they were actively putting the fires out on, and this had real potential to be a solid, enjoyable game.
Now, for me, I found this one a little light. To me, it felt a lot like Wingspan, maybe even Wormspan, that step above, maybe a small step above. I honestly think Wormspan's a little more common. It's like between those two games. It's almost a gateway game. To me, it's a next step game. I think experienced gamers are going to find it lighter than they expect. Whereas introducing it to someone who doesn't play a lot of hobby games, probably going to be overwhelming. You're going to get confused by terms like tucking cards and things like that. Where I think this would work with new gamers is if you have that experienced player there to teach it, to walk people through it. Because the four actions are simple, right? Like draw cards, play cards, activate cards, or do the things on the board. But the things on the board are like gather resources or get a new worker. Like they're all very easy to resolve. And like I said, if you have any hobby game experience, some of this is going to feel familiar. Now, this also, though, does have that depth and potential card combos and engine building. And that's where the experienced hobby gamers like myself are going to be interested and invested in figuring out those combos and figuring out different ways to play and trying out the different characters who each have their own different kind of way to maximize use, like to optimize them, right? Like to figure out, oh, with the aggregating lord, I really need to collect these cards to score points.
Yeah, I agree. Hobby gamers are going to enjoy that puzzly engine building aspect of the game. And I do think that for hobby gamers, the game will feel simple to pick up. But I think it is not a beginner's game. I think beginners will be overwhelmed by this game for people that are not normally playing hobby games. I think it is more Wormspan than Wingspan, and it's not quite a gateway game. It's just like one step through the other side of the gate. And with that, we come to the end of our preview of Estate Raise the Realm. Hey, look at us talking about the new hotness and not yet released games.
Speaking of the new hotness, what are you hyped about right now? What coming soon game are you excited about and can't wait to get? It could be something releasing to retail soon or an upcoming crowdfunding project. Let us know in the comments, hit us up on social media, or start up a conversation on our Discord. Well, that was the double bell.
That means our shift's coming to an end and we're going to have to lock the lobby doors.
Before we start locking things down, let's take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons. Ron F. Thank you, Ron.
Brian Van Beek. Thank you, Brian.
William Fisher. Thank you.
Andrew Dacey. Thank you, Andrew.
Danielle and Owen Thomas. Thanks, folks.
Sean P. Kelly. Thank you, fellow Sean. Well, your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but you can find us all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and in your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Again, I'm going to say probably the single thing we would most love in the universe right now is reviews. If you enjoy the show, please head over to Spotify, Pandora, Apple Podcasts, wherever you listen, and leave us a review and help others discover our show.
And one way you can show your love and possibly get someone else to go, what's that? Is check out the Tabletop Bellhop merch at tabletopbellhop.com/merch. Now, anyone who's joined us for a live show knows we run on coffee. That is the fuel that keeps the creativity coming. One of the things you can do to keep those juices flowing is support the show by buying us a cup of joe. Just head over to tabletopbellhop.com/coffee. Heck, if you really love us, you can set up a monthly coffee donation.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And
game on.